Number 14. So we stopped with the upada. Now we move on to nirodha. I ended the last lecture with an introduction to nirodha. Nirodha means the sometimes it can be referred as abhava, non-existence, passing away, vanishing, and so forth. The term nirodha can refer to following meanings within the tradition. Bhangavartha nirodha. Bhangavartha nirodha is the passing away of a reality. It can be the first passing away or the final passing, momentary passing away or the final passing away of a generation. Then this is twofold, kanika nirodha and santati nirodha. What is passed away? It means it, from the existent it comes into non-existence. The Baddhekaratta Sutta, Buddha mentioned, Yadatitam Pahinantam. Whatever it is past, it's already gone, it's no more. So therefore, don't worry about it or don't ponder about it. Don't think about it. Think about means don't waste your time thinking about it. It's not that just, Buddha didn't mention not to think about the past, but don't get attached or worry about what has happened. Yadatitam Pahinantam. So what has happened is all gone. It's no more there. You cannot reverse it back. So that is the idea of that. In the Baddhekaratta Sutta, Buddha mentioned this idea. Then this kanika nirodha is twofold: the passing away of momentarily passing away of a reality, and the ending of a generation. And if you go to the next page, you'll find anupanna nirodha. Anupanna nirodha means it's fivefold. Sammuti nirodha, radanga nirodha, vikammana nirodha, samuccheda nirodha and nissarana nirodha. I'll be focusing only on the samuccheda nirodha and nissarana nirodha. Others, when we come to the lecture of nibbana, we are supposed to explain. Samuccheda nirodha means 9.424. is the non-arising of defilements after they have been permanently eradicated by supramundane paths. This is the Nibbana Buddhists aspire to attain. This is what the Buddha referred by the term Ragakhaya in Iti Uttaka. I've given the reference with the commentarial explanation. Ragakhaya means it's no more. That this is completely eradicated. So it means the thing is Raga is not going to happen. If the latent defilements remain, these defilements would have arisen as mental states. Samuccheda. So when this is removed, these latent defilements are removed, they are also not going to happen. So when it is say raga khaya, it refers to both. That's why as I asked the third question, when it is anupanna, it refers to the both. Right? So samuccheda nirodha means when the defilements are removed, they are not going to happen. Absence of the arising of defilements and the absence of the latent defilements, they are the same. Right? This is called samuccheda. It's the nibbana actually. It's the nibbana. Nibbana can be explained in two ways: getting rid of the defilements, getting rid of the suffering. Right? So nissarana nirodha, they are not different, but nissarana nirodha emphasizes mostly on the suffering. Is the non-arising of aggregates that would have occurred had the causes prevailed. For instance, aggregates that would have arisen after seven lives in the karma realm become ceased before their arising when defilements have been eradicated with Sotapatti Magga. This is the Nibbana referred by Arahants with the phrase Kina me jati, my birth has been removed. So when these defilements were removed, so the first one, first nirodha, for example, this is called samuccheda nirodha. When these are removed, for example, let me say this again. When this is being removed, this becomes removed without arising. That is called nissarana nirodha. Nissarana nirodha. So when the birth has been, I have removed the birth, for example, when Arahant says, you cannot get rid of the birth of this life and he cannot get rid of the death of this life. You know, Buddha had to face the death. Right? You can see in Digha Nikaya it mentioned, even the Kalamakari Muni, the Muni, the sage, the great sage, passed away. He had to face the death. Immense of suffering before he dies. He mentioned to Ananda, my body is like a worn out cart. It's like, it's a decayed cart now. It's fully gone. It's the strength is completely gone, and he has to undergo some diarrhea during that time. So this, so when Arahant says he's free from death or birth, he's referring to the birth and death that would have arisen had the defilements remained. So that is called Nissarana Nirodha. I skipped the first three purposely, right? Anupajjana Nirodha is also, they are the same. Now, as you asked, they are sometimes the same thing will be repeated in this case. Because in the Upada, specifically I remove them to get rid of the confusions. Anupajjana Nirodha is a non-existence of non-arising of defilements that have been permanently irrigated by supramundane paths accordingly. It is another synonym for Samuccheda Nirodha. For example, this same. This can also call Anupajjana Nirodha. After it has been removed, they are called Anupajjana Nirodha. It's after being removed, but it's not arising anymore. Right? This, in the first Nirodha, we talk about the removing. And then the second Nirodha, we are talking that they are not arising anymore. So there are different aspects focusing on the Nibbana. Anupatti, Anupajjana, Samuccheda, Nissarana. So these all are synonyms for Nibbana, terms related to Nibbana. The same thing is given different approaches. Then Apalaraha Nirodha is a very important point. The past Kamma which are in the state of Kamma Samangita but are unable to yield results as the defilements have been eradicated. When kilesas have been permanently removed by Lokuttara Maggas accordingly, past Kammas fall into this state. This is what is being referred in the literature as Kammakkaya. In the Ratana Sutta, okay, I'll first explain this. Now, we also mentioned in the previous lecture, when these latent defilements are removed, this ability of giving results will be removed. This is what will be removed. Not the Kamma Samangita. Kamma Samangita will remain. Kamma will remain. You cannot eradicate the Kamma. This Kamma Samangita, removing the ability of giving results. Why is that? Food for giving results is the kilesa. When the kilesas are removed, Kamma is not going to give results after death. For this life, Kamma still can give results. That is what happened to Buddha, Moggallana, and many more. Because not only the Kamma Vipaka, every Chakku Vinyana, Sota Vinyana, Kaunarija is a Kamma result. So if some Arahant lives after liberation, he is living because of Kamma. Bhavanga Chitta is still happening. The Kamma which gave the life is still going on. So for the Kamma to give a next rebirth, it needs the support of the defilements. That is the food, ahara, for the Kamma. When the relevant support is not there, it is unable to produce a result. So what happens when the defilements are removed, this ability of the Kamma to give results, give rebirth of future lives, will be removed. So this is what is said. Kinam Puranam. Puranam means Kammas one has done in the past. one has done in the past comes into the state of inability to give results, give further lives. So that is called Trina Purana in Ratana Sutta, Buddha mentions. What has been past karma has been removed. So karma kaya is also this state. Otherwise, karma cannot be eliminated, like Kelesa. In Ratana Sutta, it is mentioned that Kinam Puranam, past karmas have been exhausted or eradicated. As its commentary states, the past karma is said to be exhausted when defilements that are required by it to yield its results are eradicated. Because afterwards, it is unable to produce its results. Results here means, I'm especially focusing on the results after death, right? Not in that life. This notion is also mentioned in the commentary of Udanapali. Commentary also states that karma, and also if a karma has already yielded the results, that is an extra thing, yield the results, finish the results, that karma is also called karma has already exhausted. I'm not going to emphasize on this matter because there was a story in the Udanapali. One person encountered Akusalas who was destined to be a Pacheka Buddha. So then this person encountered a lot of suffering in samsara. Later on, because of this karma, he was suffering a lot. And then another Pacheka Buddha came to him, at that time he has changed, his gender has changed in the samsara, and he had become a lady. So then she offered this Pacheka Buddha some dana, a special dana. So the Pacheka Buddha knew his karma, her karma is now exhausted. Exhausted means it gave results, and also he did a very good karma opposite to that. So then the karma was unable to yield the results anymore. So some karmas, it become wasted after giving results. It's not going to give results anymore. But it is very difficult to guarantee when it will be finished. Because if you read the Buddha's past karmas, some karmas have been done even before he started after Bodhipankara, before Dipankara started. Such long time past karmas can still come and give result. So it is very difficult to say when a karma is finished having given result. So these sorts of karmas are also fall into this category. Category means are not going to give results anymore. But I would not focus on that much. So these are the types. Now when we come to nirodha, we talk about few nirodhas. The momentary passing away from existence to non-existence. It can be momentary or end of a generation. Then we also talk about the samuccheda nirodha, removal of lot and defilements, so they are not going to happen anymore, samuccheda nirodha. Then anupanna nirodha, nisarana nirodha, the aggregate that would have happened if the conditions prevail would not occur again, anupanna nirodha. Then anupajjana nirodha, another one. It's a nisarana nirodha is called. Nisarana nirodha. Anupajjana nirodha is also the latent defilements. Is another synonym for samuccheda nirodha, is no more. Then apalaraha nirodha means the karma comes to the state of not unable to give result. That is called apalaraha. Apalaraha is capable of giving this. A is na, opposite meaning. Apalaraha nirodha. And that is what is mentioned as kamatkaya in many, some suttas. Yes. Kamakaya? Yes, it's like this. Why this happens, state happens? Because of removal of defilements. So removal of defilements is the nibbana. When the defilements are removed, kamma come into that state. So why the word kamakaya? Buddha refers to this nibbana. Otherwise, kamma is coming into this state of kamas coming into this state, we cannot call it nibbana. But when you come to these abstract forms, that unreasoned forms, it's very difficult to distinguish the realities and the qualities. So with the term kamakaya, Buddha has referred to nibbana. Right? But it is because kamakaya happens because of the kilesakaya. Right? And also, it's only one aspect I discussed. Because this If I talk, all the aspects is getting more and more complicated. So past karma becomes unable to give results because defilements have it. And then new karmas are also not produced, right? Because the defilements are removed. So this is also called kammakaya, right? So at that time, it is also called something called nibbana, non-arising of karma. So when it comes to the non-arising, most of the time it refers to the nibbana.
So nisarana nirodha is also nibbana.
Yeah, sure, it's nibbana for sure.
And the first one.
Samucheda nirodha. No, this is just the
observation. The moment,
thing. Okay, then we'll come to bhangavata nirodha. When you say bhangavata nirodha, it is twofold: the moment of passing away, and also the non-existence of this. When you call nirodha. Not Banga, Nirodha. Nirodha is twofold. Kanika Nirodha. Just the passing away and also its absence after the passing away. Both is called Nirodha. So Bhangavata Nirodha, okay. Bhangavata Nirodha is the passing away only. Bhangavata Nirodha is the passing away.
Passing away momentarily or both?
Momentarily and generationally. Both.
Sub-moment.
But what I want to say, when you say the Bhanga Nirodha, it has two meanings. This sub-moment passing away, and afterwards it doesn't exist. This is also called Nirodha. It's just the absence of the reality. Just the passing away, and also its absence after that. Right? That is also called Nirodha. So these are subtle points. I'm not going to talk all in this point because it will make it more difficult. So then we come into, these are the points. So I hope you got the idea. This is the Upada and Nirodha. This is what is called Upada and Nirodha. So then we come to the next topic called Atita, Santata. Santata and Atita. Existing nature. Imasmin Sati Idang Hoti. Imasmin Asati Idang Hoti. Santi, Santa, Atti. Asanta Nati. Right? Attita. You can have a question. Atti tha. Tha is an abstract noun. Tadita. Atti. Atti is a verb, right? So how can it attita? These are called special type of nouns. Sometimes verbs are also used as nouns in some cases, right? Attita. Otherwise atti should be conjugated as a noun, right? Atti samti. Asi, Atti, Santi, Asi, like that, right? But Attita is used as a noun. Attita, Nattita, right? Santata, Santata is a noun. Nature of being and existent is called Attita or Santata. Few types of Attita can be fetched from the tradition's literature. First is Aviparita Attita. Aviparita Attita means being a nature that is tangible to our intellect. That is called Paramatta Dhamma. In the first lectures, in the previous semester, I discussed, reality is considered as Paramatta because it can be experienced, or it can be felt, or it can be known through, it is predicable with the intellect. That is called a Paramatta Dhamma. And to check up whether it's something a paramatta or not, you have to apply it into the four aspects of function I have given in parinya, bhavana, pahana, and satchikarana. If you want to go have more details, go to 1.4. 1.4 is not in this handout. It was the first handout I gave when we began these lectures in ultimacy. Right? I started the lectures with the history of the Theravada tradition. Right, in the ultimacy lectures 1.4 I have given an explanation. That whole number one sort of handouts were related to ultimacy, right? So this if something has its intrinsic nature, if something can be known through intellect, if something is irreducible, if something of something's characteristic can be experienced through intellect, these are called ultimate realities. So when you investigate, your wisdom will in the end find out a certain quality. This quality is tangible to the wisdom. But if you investigate the idea of Purusha, a man, you find you end up with the ultimate reality. The idea of Purusha will disappear. So this idea of Purusha is viparita. It doesn't give, it is not true in this, in the actual sense. So it doesn't exist in the reality. That is what is called viparita. It's not in the sense of lie and truth. So we have few types of samruti satcha, paramatta satcha, arya satcha and so forth. So patavi is not something that you have imagined. It is something that can be known through your senses and known through your intellect. So if when you investigate, if you find some certain qualities, these are called aviparita. So they exist, they are existent, they are existence. So that is, they are that quality, quality of being, that they are intrinsic, their intrinsic nature itself is called the attita, right? Aviparita, attita, nibbana. When Buddha said atti kassapa acelaka kassapa, to acelaka kassapa, atti kassapa dukkham, when the Buddha acelaka kassapa asked the questions, is the suffering made by you? Buddha said, I don't say like that. Sayankatan dukkham, parankatan dukkham, is suffering made by someone else? Made by someone else was, is like, some people ask this question. If it's not I am who is born, so no problem. Why do we worry about the rebirth? Yeah? This is the ucce, it's one kind of uccheda ditti, another ucce. Normally we say ucceda ditti is the self will end up. If someone says the one who does the karma and the different one experience the karma, it means the person who did the karma has already vanished and a different person has arisen in the next life. This is also ucceda, another type of ucceda. So Buddha said, no, I don't say like that. I don't say parang katang kamma. Then he asked the questions, is it done by you and someone else? He said, I don't say like that. Is it done by the fourth question he asked with the negation? Then he had the question, do you know, is there suffering? Because the Buddha said, suffering is not done by you. I don't say like that. Suffering is not made by someone else. I don't say like that. Is made by someone else. I don't say like that. Suffering is not made by you or anyone else. I don't say any such of statement. Then he asked the question, is there a suffering? Yes, there is a suffering. And do you know the suffering? Yes, I know the suffering. So the purpose, when he said, yes, there is a suffering, atti, say, nako kassapa natti dukkang, atti ko kassapa dukkang. There is no, it's not wrong that there is no such a thing that there is no suffering. Suffering does exist, right? So this is, mean the suffering is known in its intrinsic nature, right? So that is called aviparita, attita. They are intrinsic nature. A well-known statement of the Buddha, atti bhikkhave nibbana. So when you say atti, it's a very strong statement. Nibbana does exist. There is a nibbana. It means nibbana can be experienced with your direct knowledge. It can be attained. So aviparita attita is the existent nature of ultimate reality. In the first handout, if you refer, I have differentiated the existent nature and the existing nature. Right? I have given some detailed explanations on this. Then avatta bhuta attita or pachupan attita means if a reality, so all the conditioned realities have their intrinsic natures. So in that sense, they are attita. Actually, if you talk about the satcha, the word satcha is made on this definition. According to Theravadians, so normally when you translate satcha, it's a truth. Truth sometimes refers as a phenomenon. Truth of the world. Something that is the functioning of the world. But if you go into Theravada Abhidharma, you find dukkha has specific realities. Samudaya has specific realities. Satcha, magga, nirodha has specific realities. So what does it mean? The definition goes as santasya bhavo satcha. The nature of existing is satcha. The nature of existing is, it's their intrinsic nature. That are the realities. So this word definition is made on this philosophy. Something which can be known through intellect or senses are called existing. They have the nature of existing. Then avatta bhuta attita means a reality which has come into any of these states. The dharmana upada. So a reality which has come into in these states is called, the nature of coming into this state, reality, a state of a reality, either coming into the arising state, persisting state, or passing away state, that nature is called avatta bhuta attita. It has come into any of the three stages of existing. Right? So this is called avatta bhuta attita. So there is also a different, is not an ultimate reality, it is the presence of a reality. It's the presence of a reality. The first definition, it is the intrinsic nature. Then appahinatita. Appahinatita means the defilements that are not eradicated by noble paths. They are the anusaya kilesa and vasana kilesa. So when these defilements, when they were not removed, we call they still exist. You can find this in some suttas Buddha mentions. As long as appahinaba is not removed, when they are not removed, they still exist within you. We consider they are not free from them. That is called appahina attita. It means realities which are defilements, which are not fully removed, the latent defilements are considered as atti. Then we have upajana raha attita. It is the uneradicated defilements and aggregates that would arise if relevant causes prevail. This same attita, it means the latent defilements which were called appahina attita, they can arise in the relevant conditions. So they themselves are also called upajana raha attita, possible to arise. And also, as you say, anupanna khandas, they are also possible to arise. They are also called upajana attita, upajana raha attita. Then palaraha attita. Palaraha attita means the uneradicated defilements that causes cause the arising of aggregates after death and past kammas, which are in the state of kamma samangita, which can produce their vipaka. So it means these defilements and kamma. Palaraha means capable of giving results. So how the defilements are capable of giving results? There is a very nice sutta given by Buddha. If you refer to the footnote 18, yayacha bhikkave avijjaya niyutasya balasya yayacha tanhaya sampayuttasya ayankayo samudagato sacheva avijja balasa appahina sacha tanha aparikkina. This body is obtained by someone who is together, if I translate roughly, who is together with tanha and avijja. The reason, why is the reason? Because they are not eradicated. So avijja and tanha, which are not eradicated, has the capability of producing results. What are these results? They produce the future khandas that are going to happen. If these defilements were not there, such a body would not appear. A mind would not appear. So therefore, they has the capability of giving results. Not only kamma has the capability of giving results. Tanha, avijja, latent defilements also have the giving results. This is a statement given by the Buddha himself. Then the kamma giving results, it's very clear, we all know that. There are many, many statements for that. Kamma, which was done in the past, would give results, vipaka. So this kamma, which is not eradicated means when the defilements are there, when this ability is not removed, that kamma has the ability to give results. So we call palaraha attita. It is still existing because it can give results. Then defilements, when they are not removed, they can give results as new lives. So they also consider as present. So if something has the ability to give a result, this quality, this nature is also called present. It is still present. So that is called palaraha attita. Right? So the same thing I am referring in different terminologies. Avimutta attita means aggregate that are supposed to arise when as relevant causes are present. This is the notion behind Nakasika Sutta, in which the Buddha preached the liberation from mass suffering attained by stream entry. So as long as the causes are there, we are not free from the suffering. So still we are in the suffering. It's a one start of existence. In normal day, normally to our understanding, we don't think about this suffering which is going to come. We think it's not existing. But according to the Buddha, as long as we are not free from that, it is also sort of existence. So that's why in the theory of ultimacy I mentioned, there are four types of existence. Few types of existence are there. So therefore, this avimuttatita means the aggregate which are going to happen because the relevant causes are still within us. Then the natita is the opposite of these. The first atita, if you refer to the previous page, I mentioned the intrinsic nature of a quality, ultimate reality. Then that is called aviparita atita. So if you go to the next page, natita is called viparita bhavena natita. It's called viparita natita. You can change it. Viparita bhava is not necessary. Viparita natita. Viparita natita means is the nature of being a non-existent. What does it mean? Panyati. Panyatis do not exist. Asabhava dhamma. So they don't have the intrinsic characteristics. So they do not exist in the reality. So they are considered as non-existence. So that is called aviparita natita. So we should talk about the countersign in meditation. Imagine objects about our almighty God who has the entire power to do everything, right? Or a state, a permanent swarga, permanent kind of bhumi where you can live forever. So these are imaginary objects. They don't have any ultimate value. So such object concepts are called viparita natita. They don't exist. Then atita natita. Atita natita means, if you remember in the previous page, I mentioned about avartha bhuta atita or pachupana atita. A reality which has come into the state of existing is present. A reality which has already gone, passed away, is called atita natita. If you focus on that reality, it is not existing anymore. Unlike the Sarvastivadins, Theravadins consider the reality which has passed away is no more existing. So that non-existent nature of a reality is called atita natita. Anagata natita means the reality which has not arisen yet. If you focus on that reality, it is not existing. This is the possibility of arising. It's not the future reality. Future reality is the when it arises, that particular reality. It is no more at the moment. So that is called anagata natita. So Buddha mentioned this in the Vadyakarata Sutta, yadatitam pahinantam appattam cha anagatam. The future has not yet attained. It is no more. It is not in the existence. But Sarvastivadins consider they are still existing. But according to Theravadins, past and future are not existing anymore. Then we come into some points. Pahinanartita. Pahinanartita means when the defilements have been eradicated, they are no more. Right, defilements have been eradicated. I mentioned in the atita, appahinatita means as long as they remain, we find them as existing. But when they are removed by the defilements, they are no more. That is the nibbana. That is the nibbana, samuccheda nibbana. It's no more. So defilements are removed by the supramundane parts. There are two types of latent defilements. One is anusaya, other one is vasana. Anusaya is removed by arahants and paccheka buddhas. But four parts of the arahants and paccheka buddhas, anusaya is removed. But a sammasambuddha removes both anusaya and vasana. Vasana kilesa is not capable of giving a result, but it is capable of making certain physical and bodily actions. That's why sometimes arahants, even if they don't have kilesas, they may look like they are looking with lust, like and with anger, with delusion. It appears likewise. There was an arahant called Pilindavaccha. He talked to others, like especially for low caste ones. He talked to them as vasala. Vasala means the outcast. Some even got offended. Then when it was informed to the Buddha, he mentioned this is the habit he has in samsara, being born in the Brahmin life for many years, many lives. So he has the habit. Even he doesn't have dosa, he still says that. And there is allowance in Vinaya because of this vasana. It's called his name is one who brings the foot up. It's called like a cow. You know the cow? After some time, he brings the food into up and he keep on chewing, right? So this is called, there is a special name for this monk. Even recently, I remember it, right? For him, normally, we are not allowed to do it, right? We are not allowed to do it. Allowance was given to this monk He can do it because he cannot stop his habit, but for him even, he should not bring it outside the mouth and eat. Right? Its allowance was given, he should not bring it outside the mouth, the food, and eat back. That is called, I forgot the name, it's a very nice, allowance only for this person. That is the only Vinaya rule as I remember. Allowance was given particular to one monk because he is out of control. He cannot control because of his habit. These are called vasana kilesas. Vasana kilesas means the habits imprinted in our mind stream because of our past defilements. Because of these vasana kilesas, Pacheka Buddhas and Arahants doesn't get the full efficacy in their wisdom like a Samma Sambuddha, right? Vasana kilesas. It is not a kilesa that would cause for rebirth, right? That was called for rebirth. It is like the smell of when the pot is being removed, the liquor is being removed from the pot, still there is a smell. So likewise, there is a certain habitual impact, right? So I have given the explanation. The Pacheka Buddhas and Arahants remove the anusaya, and whereas both anusaya and pasana kilesa are indicated by the Lokuttara Maggara or Samma Sambuddhas. Well, this non-existent latent defilement is called Samucheda Nirodha or Samucheda Mukti, right? Then Anupajjana Raha Natita. Anupajjana Raha Natita is the non-existent of latent defilements that would have arisen unless they were permanently eradicated by supramundane paths, and non-existence of aggregates that would have arisen had the relevant causes prevailed out of the two types. So this Anupajjana, I mentioned Upajjana Raha Natita is for the latent defilement that would have arisen and the aggregates that would have arisen. So Anupajjana Natita means when they are removed, they are not going to happen anymore, and the latent, the aggregates are also not going to happen anymore. So their absence is called Anupajjana Raha Natita. The same thing was explained in different manners, right? Different aspects. Then Apala Raha Natita is the past karma which is the past karma which are in the state of karma samangita that would not yield their vipaka, either because they have already produced their results or they do not have the required support of the defilements to bring forth their results. Right? So it means the same thing I mentioned about aparāraha nirodha. The karma comes into the inability of producing results. So that is why even anagami has do lots of wholesome deeds, kama vachara deeds, giving dana, practicing vipassana and so forth. But as long as his kama raga sanyojana is not present, these kamas are not going to give rebirth in the kama realm. Right? Their kamas are become incapable in giving rebirths in the kama realm. So likewise, this incapability is called apalaraha natita. Then vimutta natita means the non-existence of these realities that would have arisen if the conditions prevail. So this is how we look into the meanings. So it's a list of very profound kind of explanations. The same thing sometimes has been explained in different aspects, but the thing is, these different aspects are found within the literature. In certain suttas, Buddha have made such approaches. So it shows that he had such a holistic picture about this. So then that's why the suttas should not contradict with each other, because they were having a very firm foundation like this. I'm not saying it was like this, a similar foundation like this. This is what the tradition has informed. But you cannot find this information in one place, right? This is how we gather the building blocks and we get such a picture. This is how it has been explained. So then we come into another two aspects. For example, I'll conclude the lecture and take this to the next lecture because it's too much of information otherwise. So for example, now if I give an example why this information is important, why I started with such a detailed, profound and head-paining information in the mail of causality. Maybe you got fed up of causality, this is enough, right? So the thing is, this kind of explanation, if you have a certain idea, you'll be able to relate whatever causal relationship in a proper way. For example, we say, imaste sarvidam bhavati imas upadanam upacchati. Because of when this is present, this would happen. Because of its upada, that would arise. So something like that. So this, this is when this is present, it is also found. Then because of its upada, the other one would arise. So this is the rough translation. So how do we understand? Avijja pachya sankhara viko. Because of avijja, we produce sankhara. The normal idea is because of avijja, we do certain wholesome and unwholesome deeds. Right? So at the same time, avijja pachya sankhara. When avijja is present, we accumulate sankharas. Then the next thing is avijja pachya. When avijja upada. You have to apply this. Avijja pachya sankhara means because of avijja presence, sankhara is present. Because of avijja upada, sankhara arises. Right? So when we have avijja, we produce certain actions. If you go to the later level, as long as avijja is present, the past sankharas that we have accumulated are still in the state of giving results. So as long as avijja is there, sankharas are also present. So then whether a certain avijja is related to a certain sankhara, you don't need to relate them. In the fundamental level, as long as avijja is present, sankharas, whatever sankharas that we have accumulated, not in the past life. For example, we call avijja and sankhara belong to the past life. But is it necessary that our rebirth is only because of the karmas in this life? It can be a past life karma, right? Okay? So, but for example, if I am born in a good place, okay, I imagine I am born in the Devarayam, right? I don't want to talk, I am born in the awful place. So if I am born in the Devarayam, if I am born, unless I eradicate the kilesas, which is very unlikely because of its difficulty. Anyway, so if we are born again, for example, I hope it happens in a good realm, for example. So think that I am born in a good realm because of past karma that I have done in the past lives. So when I explained about the vijnana of the next life, did it happen because of sankhara? Yes. Did it happen because sankhara happens avijja? Yes. So if I explain normally in the conditioned level, that sankhara has occurred long time before. Avijja also because long time, because of certain avijja addicted karma. But even in this life, avijja was latent there. That karma also existed as a karma force, because according to Buddha, it follows us. Even in this life, it was present, the potential was present. So, avijja, as long as avijja is there, sankhara is in the state of giving results. Why is that? Because the latent avijja is also called upada. Because of the upada, upada means the presence, not the arising. Because of the presence of this avijja, a karma that was done in the past, in a past life, is still in the capability, of yielding results. So avijja pachaya sankhara. So it's not only that because of ignorance we are accumulating new karmas. The karmas which we have accumulated also in past lives, as long as avijja is not removed, are still in the state of giving results. So therefore, even it is a karma of past life, still the formula matches. Avijja pachya sankhara. Right? Sankhara pachya vijnana. A sankhara, for example, if my next rebirth happens with a very past karma, so what happens? That karma still exists within us in a different stage as a force. This karma is giving the results, vijnana. Why? That karma was present as long as it was in the state of, giving the result, ability to give result. Then we come to the nirodha vara. Avijja nirodha, sankhara nirodha. When the avijja is removed, what happens? We are not accumulating new sankhara. Is it the new? Now, for example, he is not doing new sankhara. So Buddha mentioned Navang Nakti Sambhavang, new Sankara is not happening. At the same time, we cannot forget the past Sankara, past Kamma is also exhausted. So when we say, when we only look in the conditioned nature, we can understand because this is removed, new Kamma is not accumulated. What about the past Kamma? What happens according to this statement? When avijja is removed, this Sankara also get removed, nirodha. What is this nirodha? It comes into the state of incapable of giving results. If you remember apalaraha nirodha, apalaha nirodha means the kamma, the potential ability of a kamma to give results is removed. So when we say avijja nirodha, sankhara nirodha, it means because of avijja is removed, we are not accumulating new kamma. When the avijja is nirodha, removed, past kammas lose the ability to give results. So that is why this sort of a broad apprehension is necessary. So then whatever the possibility based on, because we have different fundamentals. We have very clear fundamentals Buddha mentioned in a sutta, I forgot that sutta. He mentioned it's not because of the kammas that you do in this life, you are born next life. All the past kammas that are done in samsara sometimes can give results into the next life. So when all these information are found in the literature, how could we, the paticca-samuppada, conditional, causal condition, how do you call it? Dependent origination is a very basic kind of a fundamental in our sasana. How could we apply, bring all this information and still can match this formula? So that is why this kind of a broad apprehension, holistic kind of a picture is necessary. So that is what I want to emphasize today. So I'll stop the lecture with here, because we discuss in these two lectures about basic characteristic of cause and effect. And also we discussed about few types of uppada, few types of nirodha, few types of attita, few types of nadita, and we gave a brief explanation how they are related with this. Yeah, you didn't fully digest this. I know it took long time for me to digest it. It was really a headache for me even while writing, because still I know it is not a complete handout, and I guarantee that you don't find this in one place. This is like information as here and there. It's really fine scattered, but you understand that the commentators did have such a holistic picture. But the beauty is when you refer to various suttas, Buddha also has referred in different terminologies in different sutta, so it indicates that he was also based on such a base knowledge. Otherwise, he was a person who is just delivering the teachings without any base. I don't think Buddha was such a person. He was such a smart, accurate person. So it is very likely that he had such a base on the understanding base. So that was the purpose of the tradition. I'm assuming that based on this, from the traditional point of view, this is how the Theravadians explain. And we will see in further weeks, future weeks, the coming weeks, how we can apply this kind of a holistic idea into Paticca-samuppada and explain all the possibilities of it happening. But normally you will see the Paticca-samuppada in a general way, because of this, because it happened. But you can, even someone who knows the Dhamma can ask lots of questions which you cannot explain. But when you have such a detailed basic fundamentals, you are able to explain them even very clearly. So that was the purpose of this detailed exposition. So if you have any questions. Yes.
In your classifications of nirodha.
Yeah.
So how about nirodha samapatti? So because generally we just call nirodha samapatti, but in this text it is always called as sannyasa vidaita nirodha. So it is not the samuchheda nirodha as far as I understand, because even though I don't see it in the suttas, in our tradition we say that the anagami can also experience it. So is it like a khanika nirodha just, or how would you?
I think you all didn't hear the question, right? Okay, I have to repeat the question. So Bhante is asking a very good question about, now I was mentioning about five types of nirodha. So where does the nirodha samapatti falls into? Nirodha samapatti. Because in the text it mentions about sanya vedaita nirodha. normally the word comes. Sanya, Veda, Itana. Sanya is perception. Veda, Itana is Vedana. It's a synonym for Vedana. The cessation of Sanya and Vedana is called Sanya, Veda, Itana, Nirodha. So where does it fall? Because it is just, is it just a mere absence of Chitta? Or is it just Samuchcheda Nirodha? Because Bandhi is also asking, because we know it cannot be attained by unless you are Anagami. And also you can ask another question. What about Asanya Sapta? According to our tradition. I am adding the question, Bandhi's question. Do they have Sanya and Vedana? However, Buddha referred to this as, he had referred to Asanya beings as Asanyino Avedano. Avedano. The Sariputta has referred. There are certain beings who doesn't have perception, who doesn't have Vedana. So it's equal. So isn't Nirodha Samapatti and Asanya Satta life is equal? Is it a Nibbana? What is the difference? Why Asanya Satta can be attained by a Putujana while Nirodha Samapatti can only be attained by an Anagami? So what is the difference? So why it is not, if it is so, why it is not included here? Is a very good question. So that for this, you find a sutta in the Anguttara Nikaya, 9th Nipada. To my understanding, I'll correct my reference. Dikta Dhamma Nibbana, something, a sutta like that. This was delivered by Venerable Ananda, as far as I know. I'll correct the reference if it is wrong. Right? If it is wrong. He mentioned about all the 8 jhana samapattis and the nirodha samapatti. That nirodha samapatti is explained as nipparyaya ditta dhamma vedaniya nibbana. Nipparyaya means it is an ultimate liberation. Nirodha samapatti is equal to samuccheda nirodha. It is equal to samuccheda nirodha. Then you have a question. What is the difference? Samuccheda nirodha is attained by a sotapanna. Samuccheda nirodha is attained by a sakadagami. Then what is the samuccheda nirodha attained by a sakadagami, sotapanna? And what is the nirodha samapatti samuccheda, which I say as samuccheda nirodha, nirodha samapatti attained by anagami? The difference is nibbana is always, is not mixed with sankhara. Sotapanna has attained the nibbana and anagami has attained the nibbana, but normal life this dukkha is still existing. They are not mixed. It's not a nibbana mixed with dukkha. While the dukkha is existing, nibbana is also attained. It is like a person who is stuck in the earth. Person stuck on the earth. So first time his head comes out. Second time he comes out till the waist. Third time he comes out till the knees. Fourth time he comes out till the ankle. Fifth time he is fully liberated. This is like a putujana. He is not liberated. Sotapanna is liberated because beyond 7 lives, some kalesas, he is free from them. But still, certain suffering is existing. Liberation is like the sky. Suffering is like the part which is on the earth. Earth and sky are different. They are never mixed. The suffering a sotapanna is having is nothing mixed with the liberation. Liberation is a different state. Suffering is a different state. We will come to a detailed explanation when it comes to Nibbana, next chapter. Sakadagami has liberated more than that. Anagami more than that. Arahant is fully liberated, but still he is encountering certain sufferings in this life. That is why the given was the ankle example. After the Parinibbana, he is fully liberated. So, the Samuccheda Nibbana and the Nirodha Samapatti Nibbana, the difference is Samuccheda Nibbana is attained. It's like the ankles, like for example, if you took Arahant, still suffering is remaining, the kaya, the dukkha. Nirodha Samapatti, another suffering is temporarily removed. Only the body exists, it cannot be felt, but the body does exist. Nama is temporarily ceased. So, he's still in the Samuccheda Nibbana. Arahant is always in the Samuccheda Nibbana, but still he encounters certain suffering. In the Nirodha Samapatti, even that suffering is temporarily removed. So, Venerable Ananda says, this Samuccheda Nibbana is Nipparyaya Nibbana. Nirodha Samapatti is Nipparyaya Nibbana. I'll give you the sutta reference next week, for sure. Or I'll give you personally which sutta it was. Other eight Samapattis he mentions as Pariyaya, not ultimately. Jhana, the liberation. I think it was the jhana itself. Then the question comes, I also have to explain the other possibilities. Nirodha Samapatti also have the absence of Chitta Chetasikas. So when you talk about the absence of Chitta Chetasikas, it is, as Bhante said, it is the Bhanga Avastha, Bhanga Avastha. So Nirodha Samapatti can be explained in two ways. First is, because his kilesas are already removed, he has attained the Nibbana, but as Arahant still have the Dukkha, that even a part of that dukkha is temporarily removed, so he's experienced the Nibbana in a very higher than a normal Arahant. Normal Arahant is free from the rebirth and everything, but still have Nama Rupa Dukkha. But what Nirodha Samapatti says is, the Nama Dukkha is temporarily removed, held back. So it is a more bliss. So that's why Arahants would like to enjoy that. Right? Asanya Satta, we are only holding the mind for a while, but we are not liberated, because we are going to have the suffering again. This is this Nibbana. Then you have a question. What is the difference? Arahant doesn't have a feeling. Asanya Satta doesn't have a feeling. What is the difference? To understand difference, we should know what is Avedaita Sukha and Vedaita Sukha. I'll be explaining this, surely explaining this when we come to the Nibbana chapter. Without knowing the difference of Vedaita Sukha, Avedaita Sukha, we cannot understand Nibbana clearly. So there is a very huge difference in Asanya Satta, absence of Chitta, and Nirodha Samapatti, absence of Chitta. The thing is, briefly if I say, I'll explain this in detail when we come to lecture of Nibbana. The thing is, the Arahant in the Nirodha Samapatti has already been free from the suffering. Or Anagami is free from the suffering. So Asanya Satta being temporarily held back, but he's not free from the suffering. Anagami or Arahant in the Nirodha Samapatti has temporarily held the mind suffering, but he is free from the suffering which is going to happen. So in the Nirodha Samapatti, in Asanya Satta, the temporal absence is there, and he is not free from it. But in Nirodha Samapatti, he is free from it, and also the temporal absence is there. Because in Vinaya perspective, that is why I came to this point. Even though in the Sutta perspective, I explain Nirodha Samapatti is a Nibbana. According to the Sutta given by Venerable Ananda, Nipparyena Nitya Dhamma Vedaniya Nibbana. There is no secondary explanation. It is, in the first place, it is a Nibbana. But when you come to Vinaya perspective, it is a Sutta. Yeah? Anupubba Nirodha Sutta. Sorry, my reference was wrong. So then, in the Vinaya perspective, Nirodha Samapatti is discussed in the sense of absence. Because Samapatti, in the Nirodha Samapatti, Chitta is not going to happen. Because after the Neva Sanyana Sanyayatana Chitta, Chitta is, there is going to be Achittaka time for a certain period. This absence is just a mere absence. So therefore, according to, if you focus on that absence, it is an empty idea. It is neither sankata nor asankata. It is not neither parama. The discussion goes like something like that. Then, if someone claims, this is the point, in the Vinaya perspective, normally if you claim without being an arahant, if a monk claims you are arahant, what happens to him? He becomes parajika. If someone without attaining jhana, if he claims he attains jhana, what is it? It is parajika. But the commentary states, because of this absence, just focusing on this absence, if someone says, I have attained Nibbana, he is still Parajika. Because because of attaining, he is focusing on this state. So if someone states that that he attained the nirodha samapatti just for lying. As the nirodha samapatti is just the mere absence, not the nibbana state, just the mere absence. So there is no parajika for this person. Why is that? According to Vinaya perspective, there are two ways to look into nibbana. As the nibbana, dittadhamma vedaniya nibbana in Sukhavi, and also as Bhante asked, absence of chitta chetasikas. If with looking into the absence of chitta chetasikas, this is mere absence of chitta chetasikas. So they are like asanya satta absence, right? So therefore, in that sense, it is not considered as a nibbana. So that is why how you look into this nirodha samapatti. If you look into the absence of chitta chetasikas, it is a mere absence. Or if you look into the liberated aspect, it is a how do you call it? It is the nibbana. It is a nibbana, right? That's how I would explain. And it doesn't mean that the asanya satta is not liberated. There is a certain liberation in him when you focus on the suffering. So we'll come to this explanation when it comes to nibbana. So we can explain. Nirodha Samapatti actually in three aspects, Asana Satta in two aspects. Yeah. Any questions? So we'll meet on next.